before he touched me. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Oh, since I met this blessed Savior, and since he cleansed and made me whole. Oh, I will never cease to praise him.
To praise him.
I'll shout it while eternity rolls. Oh, he touched me.
God bless you. I am Mark Anthony DiBello. Please, let's begin with a prayer. And in this case, end with a prayer. I'll explain that in a moment. Father, thank you for letting us speak to you and be in your presence. You are the kind of God who hears and answers prayer. Thank you for allowing us to have this life and be loved by you, this precious gift. Thank you, Holy Father, for being who you are, holy and perfect, all-knowing, all-powerful, being everywhere in this universe, this planet, this future, this eternity. Thank you, Holy Father. Holy Father, please forgive us for our sins and weaknesses, our transgressions, our indiscretions, everything we do that's unholy or ungodly or sinful. Holy Father, please forgive us for our sins against you and humanity, our fellow brethren. Holy Father, we know we are to serve and save the brethren and one another, and when we don't do that in our way, we disobey and reject you. We let our human pride supersede your desire for our sacrifice and our service. So we ask you to please forgive us. Holy Father, please bless us this day, this precious gift. Blessed is this day that you have made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for your promises of food, clothing, and shelter. Thank you, Holy Father. And please answer our prayers. We know all we need to do is to ask you. You already know what we need. Bless us spiritually and mentally. Bless us physically, Holy Father, emotionally, and if need be, materially. Please, Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen. As I've noted before, amen means I believe. I believe, we believe God hears our prayer. God answers our prayer. So, amen. Well, God bless all of you. I want to thank you all who have listened. As I noted, and it's been a couple days, or at least a day and a half, I apologize. I've been under some traumatic attacks and had some technical difficulty yesterday or the day before. But this will be the final message in this way of communicating to you and delivering these prayerfully these messages of enlightenment and education for the Lord God. I want to thank each and every one of you who's listened and those who, at any time, I mean, these messages are there for, I pray and hope, for eternity, or at least in this technological age, and I'm blessed and grateful for that. And again, you allowed me to share my prayerfully, again, godly thoughts with you, but mostly you gave me your time, the time in your life that's so precious and valuable and passes by us so quickly in this existence. And I'm truly honored and truly grateful to you and blessed by you myself, I am certain. So I wanted to personally again thank you. So this message, and God say God bless you, and this message will be the final in the How series. We've done Who, What, Where, When, Why, and How, about seven, I think, maybe six of each. The only thing I can think of for this one, this message, this final message, would be how to die. How to die, since this series is dying, this way of communicating with you is dying, and we as humans shall die. So this message will be how to die, and then I might find another way to preach to you, but right now my main focus and goal is the dissemination and distribution of the book I finished, and I prayerfully hope his pray is finished. It seems I always have to edit something in the Archangel. But the ultimate goal is to turn that into a movie. And then there's a goal after that. And I was reminded of it last night on television broadcast that reached millions. But the goal has always been for me, God bless us, to preach the gospel to the masses. And what's the best and most efficient and productive way to do that? And that's through the television, the media of television, and with the largest audiences. And those are basically, as we just wrapped the Super Bowl, or sporting event, the Super Bowl and the Academy Awards. So that's my plan, and it's been my plan for quite a while. I know I haven't been efficient in getting to that point, and I know I've been disobedient to the Lord, but prayerfully I'm still trying, and prayerfully I have another born-again experience and become more greatly inspired and enlightened and in greater service and submission to Him, greater sacrifice, and prayerfully the greatest of all success in that regard. It's all that really matters for me. So, again, I thank you for what I've been calling a spiritual journey here. As soon as I wake, I go through my routine of either saying prayers and meditating, or meditating and saying prayers and even meditating some more. And that's also included this bit of preaching and speaking on this spiritual journey. I know it's not been the most quote-unquote professional, but it's been real, at least. And I've opened myself and my life to wanting to share and be with you. And whoever you are listening, it doesn't matter. You're my fellow man. And again, we're all just hopefully trying to draw closer to the Lord God, because in the end, He's the only one that matters. I mean, He gave us life, and That's where we spend our eternal life. So let me note a few things here, the time we have remaining, about how to die. And I mentioned the archangel. And I know some ways not to die. And as outlined in the archangel, there's three subplots, and I've briefly spoke of these during these messages, were the abortion issue, capital punishment, and euthanasia. I know these are three ways not to die. We don't die by killing our children. We don't want to be that child who died, I can promise you. A child wants to live, is born with a spirit of wanting to live, of life, even as soon as the thought comes in mind to create the egg, which is the child, 9 months or 40 weeks of gestation. Just even when we conceptualize, a parent conceptualizes the thought or says, I want to have a child, and chooses to physically consummate that thought or process. As soon as that thought comes to mind, it's prayerfully, it's a thought from God to be fruitful and to multiply. As Adam and Eve did with Cain and Abel, God's first commandment before the 10, be fruitful and multiply. So prayerfully, we don't abort one another, and we perpetuate our life for the Father, for God, our Creator. I mentioned capital punishment. Jesus was sent to the cross, capital punishment, murdered by the state and the people, the will of the people. And he himself allowed it to happen, but even said, forgive them, Lord, they know not what they do. And this was God we crucified and we murdered. And he didn't even murder anybody else. He was simply on trial for being God. And they ultimately labeled the charge of being an insurrectionist or a rioter on him, because he dared to claim that, tell the truth that he was God in the flesh. But even if one were to murder another one, Moses murdered a person. I mean, there are many biblical, especially Old Testament biblical great men of God who murdered. Paul murdered people. I know he's New Testament, but King David murdered people. Sure, maybe it's not, I don't believe it's recorded, but King Solomon. Maybe even, as I recall, perhaps Abraham. Cain murdered Abel. And even then God said, forgive him. Forgive Cain. Just banish him from the garden. But you do not take Cain's life. He had admonished all the people in the earth in that time to just not take Cain's life. But we only need to look as far as the commandments. It says here, God say, thou shalt not kill, period. Thou shalt not kill. And Jesus again saying, forgive them, Father, and to forgive. And then I mentioned euthanasia or suicide in any way. I mean, you hear the expression, die with dignity. That's not dignified, to kill yourself or let somebody else murder you because you happen to be in pain. Because of our parents, because of the work of the evil one, we live this existence in pain, and we need to take accountability and responsibility for that. It's the way it is, and we work and we live and we sacrifice and we try to survive through that. We don't escape a false escape to some what we think is a paradise, but it's hell. You do not take your life. That is not dying with dignity. That's a lie of Satan, for you to think that you're dignified and take control of your life. It's not your life, it's God's life. He created it, all of life. In a sense, we are all one creation from God. No reason on earth to take your life in that way. It's not dying with dignity. Well, those are some ways not to die. So if I may, let me speak about, excuse me, some ways of the ways to die. And I want to refer to the lives of the disciples, because we listen and we pray and we serve and sacrifice, even listening to these messages, and if we each have our born-again experience and are baptized as Christians or believers in God, in the person of Jesus Christ, and indwelt with the Holy Spirit, we too are disciples and apostles. We live our lives to live the gospel and preach the gospel. And if you read the lives of the disciples of Jesus Christ when he walked this earth, I mean, there's three profound examples of how the disciples died. And the first one we look at is another reason or way how not to die, and that was Judas, who betrayed Christ. And I know through study and meditation, Judas was very, very, if not closer than Peter and John to Jesus, than any of the other disciples. And that betrayal was, and I've had Judas-like experiences in my own life I can sort of relate to, not even those who tried to kill me in a spiritual attack that they probably maybe even didn't know what they were doing. When Jesus told Judas, do that which you have to do, there's probably a good way that, a way that Jesus accepted that Satan found the weakest of the disciples to work through, or the one who was closest to Jesus, or the one who was spiritually closest, and attacked Judas. And it was almost as if Jesus knew that it was, Judas was more of a, as much a victim and a conduit to that betrayal. But either way, once Judas did betray the Savior, he knew the guilt and the evil possession that was in him caused him to want to go kill himself, that demonic possession. So that's certainly to betray God, to betray the Savior. When we betray him, we basically go against what he admonished us to do in the commandments. As I noted, thou shalt not kill. When we betray Jesus, when he says, those who love me are those who keep my commands. We don't keep his commands. We betray him. He said that we could sum up all the commands with these: love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and being, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you don't love God, truly that means if you don't believe in God, you're killing yourself, basically. You're betraying Jesus. If you don't love your neighbor, you're betraying Jesus. And if you don't love yourself, surely no one who loves themselves and loves God and loves his precious, blessed gift of life, ultimately they're deceived and they're tempted and they're tricked and they're trapped, or they willfully make the choice to kill oneself. And again, that's not loving yourself, and that's betraying Christ. And then Jesus spoke of the Antichrist, those who are, he says, if you're not for me, you're against me. Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Jesus says he is the life. Our life is in Christ. Without Christ, you don't have a, you will not have an eternal life. Your life will end, and all you will have is this material existence here, and then you'll go to a hell or non-existence. But I opened this session speaking about the life of the disciples. So that's, we know Judas is not the way to die. Now you can read in the recorded scriptures the lives of the disciples of Jesus, the other two ways, the ways that they did die, all but one. And I'll get to John on the island, the Isle of Patmos, but John died in a way different than all the disciples before him. And all the disciples of Jesus Christ, each one was crucified. Each one was killed. not necessarily all were crucified, but they all had been assassinated, if you will. They were all murdered. They were all killed for simply preaching the gospel, living the gospel life. There's the story of Peter himself, who was actually crucified upside down. He was crucified not unlike Jesus. He wanted to live a life like Christ, and he kept serving and sacrificing his life, and he did that. But he was so wanted to humble himself and not be that. He learned from when he rejected the Lord at his crucifixion, and Jesus said, "When the cock crows twice, you'll reject me." Like three times, and he did, and each time God was right. Peter learned his human lesson then and said, "You know what? I've rejected you enough, Lord, so to not imitate the Lord too closely." He had himself crucified. He begged that he'd be crucified upside down, and when they went to murder Peter, he was crucified upside down out of respect to the Lord. Excuse me. But the other disciples as well, preaching the gospel. And here's what I've said before, which is profound to me, and how, like, we can truly believe that Jesus existed and who he was as God and in the human form, is that most of these, the gospels, there's four in particular, and then I also believe there's perhaps others, and you've heard these gospels of Thomas and other people, and I believe perhaps some of that, those are very true. The main thing I don't ever believe, and I don't want to get off on a tangent here, I'll never believe that Jesus was married and that Jesus and Mary were more than just friends. Mary Magdalene, that is. She was a friend of God's. They were never boyfriend and girlfriend in our modern day parlance. They were never had relations. She was never a disciple. I mean, we're all disciples, but she was never one of the, there at the Last Supper, and one of the original 12, if you will, or 13, and there was those selected after, but I won't believe any gospel where it says that. I know that's wholeheartedly untrue. But anyway, these gospels, these men after Jesus died were still preaching his name and working on his behalf, and all those years after his death, when they were confronted, the disciples, and asked if they believed in Jesus, they each one said yes, and that's what they were living their lives for, and each one was assassinated or crucified for that. And that's amazing to me, that somebody who's already dead, you'll preach 10, 20, 30 years later, you're talking about, and you're willing to go to death, not renouncing Jesus. I mean, I could understand when he was alive, he was there amongst you. I mean, if somebody tried to kill you then, and, you know, Peter probably would have been murdered or slaughtered if he did admit who Jesus was when he had the chance at his crucifixion. And Jesus, then Peter denied Jesus then, as Jesus had predicted, and probably saved his life for a while. But then was so profoundly moved and believed in God when Jesus, when he returned, when he rose from the dead, and these disciples were so indwelt with the Holy Spirit that they couldn't reject or deny Christ. Jesus says that. He said, you know, and you can tell this spiritually if you've been born again or baptized. Once Jesus is in you, you know. Well, you know when you believe. It's an amazing, miraculous thing. It's indescribable, believe me. How you just, and we, every human being has it. We just don't all honor it. That innate and inherent belief that there must be a God, or we were created somehow. But surely, as I noted, that Satan and will trap us and lie to us and deceive us, and people will believe in their own humanity, which is no more than pride. And that's the reason the devil was evicted from heaven in the first place, from a life with God. But anyways, to me, that's the most profound reason to believe that Jesus was God and that Jesus existed, and And the message of the Gospels is that people were willing, these disciples, these men were willing to die tens of years later just for their belief in that. So each of the disciples was murdered for their belief in their work and their preaching of the gospel. And Jesus said, we spoke of this the other day, said, no greater gift than this than to lay down your life, no greater sacrifice than to lay down your life for one another. Your life is not, let's say, as important as your neighbor's life. Your job is to sacrifice. We're going to die. You're going to leave the planet. Now, the choice is yours. How do you leave? Do you leave a sacrificial death, laying down your life for somebody else, or do you leave a senseless death? I mean, you can probably, I can guarantee you, since if you're indwelt with the Holy Spirit, your spiritual life mirrors or determines your physical life, your bodily existence and the way you act outside of your inner being and self and spirit. And you'll know a Christian when you hear one and see one, and the way one acts. And you'll know somebody who's indwelt with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, which even though God would had it ordained that we should all live forever, and we have that chance to live forever, but in this existence, regrettably, because of our satanic succumbing to that satanic attack from Adam and Eve, that we're doomed to die in this body, in this generation, this existence. However, when somebody has the Holy Spirit, I mean, you hear of people who sacrifice their physical life. I've mentioned it's not only your physical life, but the time in your life and your love and your life and what all the gifts that God has given you. What do you do in the cause of the kingdom? Everybody, he needs everybody to do a certain role to do their job. Now, what are you doing? To serve God, to save one another. No greater gift than this, no greater sacrifices than to lay down your life for another. So, and you hear it could be a mass accident or a crash of some sort. And you hear of one, maybe always usually less than the people that die. The others are trying to get out or escape or go save their own life. Others, few others, they stay in there in the fight or however. And they stay in there and they try to save another human life, save physically that life. When I say fight, I mean the spiritual fight. Because And again, this message being how to die. We want to live, but we also know we're going to die. And the question again is, how do you die? So we look at the disciples, and I mentioned that the disciple John, who wrote the Revelation, the book. So I mentioned John again, I'm sorry. Pause there momentarily. John, who wrote the Revelation, how did he die? Well, some say, I guess we don't know, but I believe there's a portion that, or a scripture, or some writing, maybe the Dead Sea Scrolls or somewhere found in Nag Hammadi, that there's a play that Peter might have been murdered or crucified himself, or at least murdered. But I'm going to presume that I believe that he died just simply of old age. And there brings in the as I noted, the human desire to live in this life as long as we can and appreciate this gift of life and survive in it and try to, in every waking breath, live. But then again, as Jesus said, we hate our life here. We lay it down for eternal life. We know that there's a life that's much more, that's infinite after this life. There's a life that's much more lengthy. There's a life, there's a choice, a spiritual choice between heaven and hell, where we live our next existence, indescribable existence. So John, writing for the Lord and serving, is still preaching till his dying day, and preaching in that way, how the end comes, the end of time, and all the prophecies and written in the Revelation, and I'm sure other writings, and but John just living in that way as long as he can, and not being under spiritual attack by murderers or anti-Christians, but banished and alone in exile on the island, the island of Patmos, in there. So that's a, we look at how to die, that in its way is a good and glorious way to die. But again, you must have the Holy Spirit within you. You must believe in Jesus Christ. You must be born again. You must be baptized. And you must sacrifice your life. Sacrifice in your service and love, your belief in God, and your, as the Lord said, and your, to love your fellow man, lay down your life for another, and to love yourself as well. That's how you die. We don't die in war, killing one another. You can sacrifice without, as I mentioned, without having taken another life. You sacrifice, you live your life, you don't die a senseless death, if you can tell. As a sinner, when a sinner dies, you can basically tell. Just watch the, or listen, or read the daily news. You can see all sorts of, imagine unimaginable ways of people dying. And just as I mentioned in closing here, how sin, there's one single truth, one truth, but an infinite number of lies. When it comes to how to die, we know there's basically one truth. We die having sacrificed our life for Christ. That's how to die. Well, as I close here, these messages, I want to just again thank you and tell you that I love you. I truly love you. God bless you and peace.
Perhaps never meet anymore, till we gather in the heaven's bright city, far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again, the sight struggle through this world and its toil, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of love, where the charming roses bloom and where separations come no more. If we never meet again, the sight of heaven, I'll meet you on that beautiful shore.